Om Namah Shivaya, I'm Sanchita Roy. Welcome to class 11's biology class. Today I'm going to discuss a new chapter, that is chapter number 21, Neural Control and Coordination. We have been discussing about the different types of life processes existing in the human beings. We have discussed about the respiratory system, we have discussed about the body fluid and circulation, we have discussed excretory system, muscular and the skeletal system. Now, when these systems are functioning, how these systems are getting controlled and coordinated? They are controlled and coordinated by the help of a neural control and a coordination system present in the body. So, in this chapter, we are going to discuss that how the different types of systems are controlled and coordinated to work together to perform a particular function. Okay? So, over here we will see that the human body has several organs. So far we have discussed about the different types of systems present inside our body. Each of the systems are made up of different types of organs. These organs are working together to perform a particular function. For example, if we talk about the respiratory system, in that we have seen that there are the nostrils, there is the trachea, then the bronchioles and the alveoles. So these are the different parts of the organs. These, like lungs is an organ, the trachea is an organ. So these are the different types of organs which are working together to perform a function. We have read about the digestive system in the junior classes. We have seen that there are different organs involved in that, starting from the buccal cavity, then the esophagus, then the stomach, small intestine, large intestine. All these organs are working in a coordinating manner to perform a particular function, that is to perform the process of digestion. So each of these organs are working in a coordinating manner. In order to maintain homeostasis for the normal physiology of the human body, functions of these organs or organ systems in our body must be coordinated so that they can work in a proper manner. Homeostasis means to maintain a constant body temperature. So, for that, what is important? The whole body has to function properly. For example, when we are performing an exercise, what happens? The body temperature increases. To maintain the constant body temperature, what is there? Many other physiological changes begins in our body. For example, we start sweating profusely. What is the mechanism why we sweat? We sweat to release the body heat and to maintain a constant body temperature. So what we can see, when we are performing an exercise, so many systems of the body are working together. For example, our heartbeat increases, our respiratory process, our breathing rate increases because our body needs more amount of oxygen. To fulfill the demand of the oxygen, the rate of breathing increases. So different physiological changes starts taking place in our body. So the coordination is what? It is the process through which two or more organs interact and complement the functions of one another. So they are interacting and they are complementing, then we call it as coordination. Suppose when we give you a group project, when you are working with two, three friends together, you have to be coordinating, you have to discuss the work and you have to work in a common way, then only the work can be done in a proper way. Similarly, the different organs have to work in a coordinating manner. On the other hand, integration is a process which makes two or more organs to work as a functional unit in harmony. For example, if we take about the process of digestion, when the food enters into our body and the process of digestion begins, what will happen? The carbohydrate will be broken down to glucose and the body is supposed to absorb the glucose from the blood. Who induces the body cells to absorb the glucose from the blood? It is the insulin. This insulin is secreted by the pancreas. Now, if the insulin is not being produced by the pancreas, then what will happen? The blood sugar level will increase gradually. The person in the long run can suffer from diabetes. So what is happening? There is a coordination problem and it will result in some disorder in the organ, in the individual. So it is very important for a coordinating manner to function, that all the organs and the glands should work in a coordinating manner. And who is going to take a control of it? It is the neural system and the endocrine system. Now, for instance, when we do exercise, we observe significant increase in the rate of respiration because our oxygen demand increases in our body to produce large amount of energy. Heartbeat, blood flow, sweating, etc. to meet the enhanced need of the nutrients and energy for increased activities of the lungs, heart, muscles and many other body organs. When we stop exercising, we witness that the increased activities of the lungs, heart, nerves, kidneys, muscles, etc. gradually return to normal. Thus, during exercise, functions of the various organs of the body are coordinated and integrated. If the rate of breathing is not increased, then what will happen? The oxygen demand will become lesser in our body. We won't get the energy to do the work. Now, when oxygen is entering more in the body, what is important? More amount of oxygen has to be transported to all the parts of the body. For that, what has to be done? The heartbeat has to be increased. Because when the heartbeat will increase, it will pump more amount of blood, and more amount of blood will carry more amount of oxygen to all the parts of the body. So the blood flow will be increasing in the body. Again, what happens when this is happening? The body is generating more amount of heat. So what happens? We start sweating simultaneously to reduce the body temperature. Now, when we stop doing the exercise, what happens? Now, gradually all the system will come down to normalized state. So all these systems, all the organs, all the physiological processes works in a coordinated and an integrated manner. In higher animals, two types of systems have been developed for the control, coordination and integration. What are the two systems? That is the nervous system and the endocrine system. The nervous system provides an organized network of point-to-point connection for the quick neural coordination, that is through the nerves. The nerves are connected to the different parts of the body and they are helping in the transmission of the impulses. The endocrine system provides chemical integration through hormones. Now, the nerves cannot reach to each and every cells of the body. It can pass to a certain group of cells, whereas the endocrine system, which works with the through the helps of the hormones, the endocrine glands secrete hormones, and these hormones are being provided to each and every cells of the body. First, in this video, we are going to discuss about the neural system. The neural system is the control system of the body, which consists of highly specialized cells called the neurons. Neurons are the structural and the functional unit of the nervous system. The sensory neurons detect and receive information from the different sense organs. In our body, there are different types of receptors present in our body. These receptors are responsible for collecting the impulses or the stimuli from our surrounding. For example, our eye is having the photoreceptor, which helps in sensing the light around us. Dark light, dim light, bright light. So it is the eyes is containing the photoreceptor. Like we have discussed in class 11, the different types of receptors which are present in the different parts of the body, like olfactory receptor present in our nose, which helps us to sense the smell around us. Phonoreceptor, which is present in the ears, which are helping us to perceive the sound. Okay, so different receptors are present in the different parts of the body. Now these receptors are having the sensory neurons are attached to them. They take the information from these receptors and transmit it to the central neural system, that is a CNS. Through the sensory nerve fibers in the CNS, the processing of the information is done and the conclusion is drawn. Now these sensory neurons will take the stimuli from the environment and it will transmit it to the central nervous system. The central nervous system will analyze it with its previous knowledge and then it will further bring us the response to it. Now the conclusion is sent to the different organs through the motor nerves. These effectors then show the responses accordingly. For example, over here let us understand in through this experiment. Over here it is showing that there is a fire. When our finger comes in close proximity to this fire, the skin is containing the receptors. It will help us to sense that it is very hot. Okay, so when we are touching the hot object, what will happen? The information will be transmitted by the receptors through the sensory neurons. The sensory neurons will pass to the central nervous system. Over here, it is a spinal cord. Clear? We will see that the spinal cord also is a part of the neural system. It will transmit the information to the spinal cord. From the spinal cord will understand, oh my God, it's very hot, I might get burnt. So what will happen? It will send the response through the motor neurons to the muscles. As a result, the muscles will contract. And when the muscles will contract, we will remove our finger from the burning candle and protect ourselves. So in this way, the neural system is functioning, that it is containing the receptors. The receptors will absorb take the stimuli and transmit it through the sensory neuron to the central nervous system. And from there, the information will come to the motor neurons to bring about the response. So the candle, the burning candle is the stimulus and the response is what? That we remove our finger from the fire, from protecting the finger from getting burnt off. The neural or the nervous system is present in most of the multicellular animals. Its complexity increases with the lower to higher animals. As we go to the higher groups of organisms, we will see that the modification of the nervous system is gradually taking place. If we see the Hydra, we will see that there is a nerve network is present over here. We can see in the echinoderms there are the radial nerves are present. In case of the planarium, it is the first group of organisms which are having the photoreceptors, eye-like structure over here, which are a part of the nervous system. Then we can see that there are nerves present over here. The nerves are present. These nerves are helping in providing the nervous system in the human in different organisms. As we move to the higher group of organisms, we will see that the nervous system is getting much more developed. If we talk about the human neural system, we will see that the human neural system is made up of two types of systems. What is this? The whole nervous system of the human being is derived from the embryonic ectoderm. We know that the human beings are what? They are triploblastic. We are having our body is developed from three germinal layers: ectoderm, mesoderm, and the endoderm. So the nervous system is developed from the ectodermal layer of the body. So the nervous system, the ectodermal layer of the human body is responsible for the formation of the nervous system. The human neural system is divided into two parts, that is the central neural system and the peripheral neural system. The central neural system includes the brain and the spinal cord and is the site of the information processing and control. So it is the main part, the central neural system is the main part of the nervous system where the processing of the information is taking place. And the peripheral neural system is what? It is responsible, it comprises of the nerves of the body associated with the central nervous system. The peripheral neural system is responsible for collecting the stimulus from the environment and transferring it to the central nervous system, and from there the information comes back to the peripheral neural system, which is responsible for bringing about the response. So in the flow chart we can see the nervous system is of two types: central nervous system, peripheral nervous system. Central nervous system consists of the brain and the spinal cord. The peripheral nervous system is the somatic nervous system and the autonomic nervous system. The somatic nervous system consists of the cranial nerves, that is the nerves arising from the brain, and the spinal nerves arising from the spinal cord. The autonomic nervous system is of two types: sympathetic system and the parasympathetic nervous system. Gradually in the later videos we will be discussing about each of these systems in a separate manner. The nerve fibers of the peripheral nervous system are of two types. As I just said, that the peripheral nervous system is responsible for collecting the stimulus from the environment and bringing about the response. So depending upon that, the peripheral nervous system is having two types of nerves. They are the afferent fibers and the efferent fibers. The afferent fibers, they transmit impulses from the tissues or organs to the central nervous system. And the efferent fibers, they transmit the regulatory impulses from the central nervous system to the concerned peripheral tissues or the organs, that is to bring about the response. The peripheral nervous system is divided into two divisions, that is somatic neural system and the autonomic neural system. The somatic neural system releases impulses from the CNS to the skeletal muscles, while the autonomic neural system transmits impulses from the CNS to the involuntary organ and the smooth muscles of the body. There are different functions which are taking place as autonomically in our body. They are controlled by the autonomic neural system. So the autonomic neural system is further classified into sympathetic neural system and the parasympathetic neural system. So these are the different categories of the peripheral nervous system. When do this function, autonomic nervous system, will function? For example, the sympathetic neural system and the parasympathetic, they work in a antagonistic way. When the sympathetic nervous system, when our body is in a stressful condition, our body gets excited. At that time, the heartbeat increases, the rate of breathing increases. That is done by the sympathetic nervous system. The body has to cool down. That has to be brought about by the parasympathetic neural system. These neural systems are totally none of these systems are under our control. They will function of their own. Is it clear? This somatic neural system, what is there? Over here we can control. Suppose there is a burning candle. Whether you will touch the candle or you will not touch the candle, it is the somatic neural system is going to tell us. Because our eye can see that the candle is burning. So when you see a candle burning, will you touch the flame of the candle? No, it is the eye who is sending the information to the brain, and the central nervous system will do the analysis, and it will inform the motor neurons through the through the efferent fibers. It will inform our muscles not to touch the fire. Okay, so over here there is certain control in the action. So the peripheral nervous system is having two types of fibers, that is the afferent fibers and the efferent fibers, which are helping in performing the functions. So in my next video I will be discussing further about the central nervous system. Thank you. Om Namah Shivaya.